Okay, let's see. Today is April 12th, 2015, and we do this every Sunday at 6 o'clock Eastern time. And I know a lot of people watch it live, and a lot of people watch it later on. We're going to give away. Aaron J. French has got an omnibus book, Monk Punk and the Shadow of the Unknown. We're going to give away three copies of that today to viewers. And I think that's all I was going to say. Anyway, guys on your screen now, Jacob on the right in the dark shirt, at least it's on the right, he's on the right to me, and then Aaron on the left. Now, we're going to talk about you guys' upcoming game. You just did a, I don't know if it was a Kickstarter or an Indiegogo for it successfully, right?
Yeah, Kickstarter a couple months ago, yeah.
Okay. First of all, let me apologize. I going through some medical issues right now that I won't bore you with, so if I seem a little flat, that's why.
That's fine.
But anyway, the name of the game is Icebound, and I just stumbled across it a few weeks ago and emailed you guys. I think I stumbled across it after the Kickstarter, and it looks really, really interesting, and I still don't really have a grasp of exactly what it is, but just, and I know it's not a Lovecraftian game per se, and I'm not trying to steer it that way, but I did see a few themes in there that Lovecraft fans like, you know, the Arctic setting and things like that. And it intrigued me that it seems kind of half book, half game, at least from my perspective, not knowing anything about it. Do you guys want to talk a little bit about what it is?
Yeah, sure. The kind of premise is that you are trying to help this kind of artificial intelligence simulation of this long dead author piece together this manuscript that he kind of left abandoned in pieces on his deathbed. So you're doing that partially on the game side by rearranging all these fragments of narrative and exploring different ways that might fit together, different versions of the story you might create. But then once you sort of have a version you like, you have to use this physical printed book to sort of prove that your version of the story makes sense. And so the book is kind of this scrapbook filled with all of these letters, early drafts of the book, stuff about the author's life, kind of all of these kind of second layer of pieces. But by finding sort of themes in the book or elements that connect to the story you're making in the game, you can sort of lock in your version of the story and convince this AI writer that the story you've made makes sense. And so that bridge is made by using augmented reality. So you can actually hold the book up to the camera on your PC or your iPad. It'll recognize what page of the book you're showing it and then respond to that. So
When you say iPad, does that include iPhone? Maybe a dumb question, but
For launch, it's just iPad or PCs with webcams are our two platforms. The entire dev team for this game is just the two of us. So
no, that's fine. I just wanted to be
we're
clear. I think most of us have PCs with webcams anyway, so that's okay.
So we're for launch at least, we're just focusing on those two platforms, hopefully more eventually. But yeah.
Right.
But the idea is sort of like you are collaborating with the author as it's happening. So there's sort of like the story of Icebound, but there's also the story for the reader that's evolving as you're collaborating with the author character. And the augmented reality, when you show him pages from the book, it actually sort of looks like it changes the pages of the book based on subconscious stuff that might bring to mind for the author character. And so you sort of have the physical book, but then with the augmented reality, you have this other layer of content that comes out from exploring the book and trying to find stuff to show the author. But then we sort of use that again, as Aaron said, like as a mechanic to sort of say like, you can drive the story and say like, well, you would write a story about horror. Like, here's a whole page, of something that would show that you would write stuff that's in the horror vein. And so as you're progressing through Icebound, it might become it might become a Lovecraftian story, or it might become, a sort of like personal, personal drama where not enough like action stuff happens, or not a lot of action stuff happens, but a lot of it is sort of like about emotional, the interiors of the character. And so the book is actually the way that you kind of help lock that in and guide it. So, yeah.
So there's no I was just telling my audience that we've got people that type on my message board and they can ask questions and comments, so I just said if they've got any questions for you to type in. It sounds like there's no right way to do it. It's just what works for you.
Yeah, that was definitely, with that basic idea, it could have gone a direction where it was like a puzzle game and you were trying to find the one right answer, but we really wanted, instead of that, to have a thing where you can potentially justify any story you make as long as you can find some connection to what's in the book. So it's more about kind of the act of creation and the act of editing than it is about sort of, you know, puzzle solving or figuring out the right quote-unquote answer. So,
I think this is what first caught my eye when I emailed you guys a few weeks ago. Your synopsis, it starts off, an unknown writer dies alone in an unheated New York apartment. Pieces of an unfinished novel strewn in fragments across hard drives and data sticks. A professor leads an expedition to the legendary Carina Station, an abandoned polar base sinking into ice, layers of frozen history stretching down to unmapped depths. And I won't read the whole thing, but that really caught my eye. Without any spoilers, can you talk a little bit about the Antarctic angle at all?
I mean, I don't know. Is it Antarctic or is it Arctic?
Yeah, I was about to say, maybe it's Arctic.
We actually never, we sort of are careful to always say polar, to leave it ambiguous about where, because we want to keep things uncertain about, like, what's happening or the location. But, yeah, so the basic, so Icebound has, it's got a lot of frame narratives. So the outermost layer is sort of the AI layer that we're talking about with the author. The actual book that he was trying to finish called Icebound is set in this sort of like the North or South Pole or the polar areas, and it's based around, the setting is Carina Station, which we actually, like, polar research stations until recently when they were putting them up on skis actually were always sinking slightly because of the heat. It actually slowly melts the ice that they're under, so they're always kind of sinking down. And so we sort of just, for the fiction's sake, accelerated that and said, like, Carina Station is a base that has been built, but as it sinks, the next people come around and they build another base on top of it, but then that one sinks, but then they just build another one on top of it. And so what you get from this is, like, this base that as you're exploring down further and further, you're actually also exploring down further into history. And so the setup of the game is actually you're moving through these different chapters of the book that the author's trying to finish, which are sort of like moving backwards in time. And one of the sort of the recurring questions in Icebound is sort of like, why is Carina Station there? Like, why are they, like, why don't they just build a base somewhere else? And also the sort of implication of, like, if you explore down in Carina Station, eventually you should hit the bottom, right? Like, you should hit a first station. But that never really seems to happen. And the people who go down far enough, you actually just don't really hear from them ever again. And so part of the thing about Carina Station is, like, as you're building it up, you're like, well, is there a bottom to this station? Or, like, what's down there? But then that actually also parallels, bubbles back up to the frame narrative where it's like, well, did the author ever know what was there? Or, like, what was that supposed to symbolize? Or, like, if there isn't a bottom, why didn't he put a bottom there? But if there is a bottom, like, what is it? Like, why did it have to do that? So, right. Yeah, we try to weave those things in together.
You know, a lot of people approach me about games, want to promote their games and so forth. I don't really approach other people very often, but this is a really unique idea. What inspired you? How did you guys come up with this? I know House of Leaves is one inspiration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we're both, you know, writers from, you know, most of our lives, I guess, and have only been doing games kind of more recently. So I think one of the initial inspirations for this was how to bring an experience that's more uniquely literary into the space of games. So I think, you know, the vast majority of games are trying to go for a kind of a cinematic feel. And we were really interested in creating something that was inspired by the kind of stories that work best as literature, right? So, you know, like, we talk about House of Leaves, we talk about Nabokov, Borges, Calvino. I think Lovecraft falls into that category too, you know, like, so much of what he does is created by the language, you know, more than anything else. So when we first had the chance to work together, we started to think, well, as writers, you know, what's something that we can do that's unique than what other, you know, people making games might be able to do. And then I guess the specific sort of call to action from this was a grant proposal that we applied for called Envisioning the Future of the Book. That was actually specifically looking for projects that combined a printed book and a digital app of some kind. And so we started talking from our perspective about, well, what would it mean to do that in a really non-trivial way that wasn't just kind of something gimmicky, where actually both parts of that experience were really integral to telling the full story.
And then embedded in that, where we got sort of jumped off for the fiction was, we were sort of saying, like, well, what is this future of the book like? Especially with, you know, all of the apocalyptic rhetoric floating around, like e-books and, you know, digital books versus printed books. They're like, well, why would you even have a printed book in the future? And one of the ideas that we landed on was, well, you would want to have it non-digital so that people or entities who are digital have a harder time accessing it. So there might be books in the future that people don't want to be digital because that information should not be easily accessible. And so that sort of spun off this like round of brainstorming where we were like, well, you know, say there was an AI or a person or, you know, like what would be in that book that you wouldn't want them to see? And that was actually how it, you know, the beginning of the compendium, which is what we call the book, started.
Yeah, I'm glad you're talking about that because that I had forgotten the other thing that drew me to this that seems sort of a Lovecraftian theme, you know, like books like the Necronomicon and, Rick, you probably have a whole list of Lovecraftian books in your head, but that's one example. And it seems kind of similar, you know, things that written in this book, in this compendium, that you don't want other people to know necessarily.
Yeah. I think that's becoming even more appealing as ebooks are becoming more and more prevalent, right? Like the ebook of the Necronomicon seems less exciting somehow than a dusty tome somewhere in a library, right? So I think the desire, people's desire to have this real thing that they're holding in their hands that is going to tell them something or, you know, bring them into some other world, I think is even, gets more and more attractive to people as things go more and more digital, so.
Yeah, and it's also sort of plays into, I think, to, like, the print-on-demand thing, where, like, the fiction around the book existing, like, even the physical book existing, is that it's all stuff that's been smuggled out, And I'm trying not to, like, I don't want to give stuff away, but it's like stuff that's been smuggled out from the project that gave birth to the AI author. And so there is the idea that, like, yes, the company does not want this stuff to be out there. There's the idea also that, like, it has been kept from the AI for their own protection, because there is stuff in there that might actually damage them to know. And as you're going through, you're sort of... One of the big mechanics of the game that we have is sort of like, you can show them, there's all sorts of stuff you can show them from the compendium, but some of the stuff in there is like, oh man, that's really terrible, I can't believe that happened to you. And so it's sort of like, oh, I can show them this page and give them back this memory, and then it's like, wait, maybe we don't want to give them back that memory. And so the idea is that, like, the book is forbidden, you know, in a sense, both by the company's standpoint, but also from kind of the AI standpoint. And then you find out other things later that sort of like, well, maybe I actually do want to show them this, and, you know, so, yeah.
There's definitely some kind of whisperer in the darkness element to this of, like, you know, how do you define humanity if parts, what right. parts can you take away without it starting to, you know, become creepy.
And so. the horror of waking up and realizing that you're an AI and not a human anymore, per se.
Right.
There's lots. Yeah. One of my favorite catch-22s is if you're an AI and you're having a conversation with a person who has the ability to restart the conversation with you and erase your memory as soon as you say something they don't want you to say, then you can just assume that every conversation you have with that person, you are only thinking or saying the things they want you to think or say, and there's actually nothing you can do, given that, to step outside those bounds. And so there's lots of, I think, existential horror that comes into the idea of having of being a simulated being that can have different parts turned on and off depending on the whims of whoever is simulating you. So, yeah.
A little bit different, but that reminds me a little bit of the Nick Bostrom argument that we're living in a simulation.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you guys have seen that. On this, the tech page, it says, the game's constructive narrative system is part of our ongoing PhD research at UC Santa Cruz's Expressive Intelligence Studio, an academic paper describing our combinatorial, I can't talk today, narrative system is available to those interested in more technical details. You touched on this a minute ago, but can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, the other sort of interesting part of our Venn diagram is we're both PhD students researching story in games in different ways. But so part of what drives the interaction on the game side is this kind of experimental system for making narratives that can be assembled out of pieces rather than in a pre-authored structure. So a lot of people are kind of familiar with like the choose your own adventure model for an interactive story where you have, you know, a pre-authored segment, the reader makes a choice, and then you have one of several other pre-authored segments that could follow from there.
Right, even if it's on a computer, there's still only one way to go, really.
Right, and that structure has a lot of even, you know, really mainstream big story games are still using that kind of structure because it's really easy to do, but it's frustrating as an author because it just means you're writing a lot more content and, you know, only some percentage of players are going to see any, you know, piece of that content you're writing. And the more choice you give, the more content you have to make. So it's kind of this vicious circle. So what we were trying to do with Icebound was devise a system where everyone is seeing more of the content. So you're not writing a huge amount of stuff that most people are never going to see, but they have more creativity to do interesting things with that content. So the analogy we kind of like to use is it feels more like playing with Legos than navigating a maze. So you are given all of these pieces of story. The system understands different ways they might be assembled together, and then it kind of asks you to build something out of them. And what's cool about that from our perspective is people can actually do surprising things even with relatively minimal set of content. So someone might attach, you know, one inciting incident to another dramatic, you know, reversal, and we might be like, oh, like I never thought of having that lead into this second thing. That's really interesting.
Yeah.
So,
well, and maybe one thing to insert into this is that it's not like pre-authored segments where it's just the text. It's actually the text in those segments is flexible. So the critical thing is that you can actually, when you're combining these different segments together, like the casting for each, like which characters get cast into that segment is flexible. So you may have a thing where two characters are having dinner, and it'll say, you know, like the first character cast into this is the one that's going to start the problem. Well, that might be someone who's really angry at the other character, or it could potentially be like, someone who is going slightly insane because of like isolation, or it might be someone who is like a jilted lover, and so the system can dynamically cast those in differently depending on what the context is for the system. So we sort of like split up into lots of different segments to combine together. But the critical thing, the only thing that makes that work, is the fact that those little chunks are actually kind of smart and that they kind of squish together to make a good story or a consistent story. So
it almost sounds like to me that the game is all about the journey and not necessarily finding how to quote win the game. Is that accurate?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's been really interesting to see. So it's not released yet. We're in the last couple months of finishing it up, but in testing it, it's been really interesting to see the way people approach finishing one particular part of it. So some people will sit down, kind of make the first sequence of events that they can find and be like, okay, cool, I like that, let me move on to the next thing. Other people will spend hours on that one bit, you know, trying a bunch of different combinations, saying like, well, what if this character, you know, didn't do this, or what if this happened? You know, usually with games you have like a playtime, and people ask us what the playtime is for Icebound, and we're like, well, I don't know, like 2 to 50 hours, because it really seems to vary a lot based on what particular parts of the story individual people get interested in, which is, I think it's a cool sign, because it's kind of a thing that this is doing that's different from a more linear medium like film or traditional writing. So,
the game was $22. Am I remembering that correctly?
Yeah, I think that's right. 22 or 23.
Okay.
I'd just like to make a comment. Yeah. Missed out on the Kickstarter. If you go to the website, you can still get in ahead of the game, make a contribution, and get the same Kickstarter benefit. It's not completely out of the question here.
That's a good point, and I linked to it from today's post on the Lovecraft eZine website.
Yeah, we appreciate it. It's like we're in the final throes right now of actually finishing up the last of the book content before switching over to author up the last of the digital content. It's like games, you know, usually around like $20 or $25. And so our idea is basically like you get a book with the game. And so it's going to be an 80-page full-color book. And then you get the game with it. So yeah, that's our plan. But yeah, you can order it. You can order it off of the website, and then basically we're just going to fold people in to the Kickstarter backer list, so that everybody gets theirs mailed out at the same time. So
okay, I've got some.
Are you guys a private company? How did you get started in game design? It's like it's hard to do this without backing.
Yeah. No. We have learned many things on this journey. We both kind of done really kind of smaller scale game projects, I guess, in the past. But this is the first thing that we kind of needed extra funding to do, sort of, I guess it's still a garage game, but needed a little, you know, outside help. The Kickstarter actually made a lot of sense for us, because what we wanted to do was have the book printed. You know, there's a lot of print-on-demand places you can go with where you can just print, you know, individual copies of books, but they don't give you a lot of control over the quality. And that's especially important for us because the augmented reality tech, where it recognizes the book page, works a lot better if you can control really precisely the page stock and the kind of ink used and all of these little technical details.
Otherwise, it would be really frustrating for the player.
Right, if there's too much glare on the page or other things like that, it kind of makes that not work as well. So we wanted to work with a real book printer, but then you have, you know, these really large minimum order sizes, like 2,000 copies or whatever. So the Kickstarter thing made a lot of sense, because there actually was a specific amount of money we needed to raise in order to do this print run. And then the advantage of the economies of scale is once we're doing that many, it's not costing us that much more to do extras. So everyone basically is able to get the book for cheaper than if we were doing it on print-on-demand.
And we're both also PhD students, so we're kind of doing this. I guess the equivalent would be like part-time game dev. But it's good to be, you know, the program that we're in, all of our research is sort of geared around pushing new ways to get, like, a higher quality story or more dynamic story into games. And so it's been good because we can develop this game, but it's also folding into our research. So it's not totally like this crazy thing we're doing in our own time.
Tell us about this. What are your doctoral degrees in?
So it's computer science, but the research lab we're with is called the Expressive Intelligence Studio. And it's all people studying various ways of getting AI into games or new kind of models of storytelling and stuff into games. So we've had people out of our lab who have done research into, like, you know, bots that play StarCraft, you know, competitively. There's people who have are, you know, working on new tools for authoring content in games that are taking advantage of, code that can help the author of, like, say, a game level anticipate, like, what they need to do next, so they're not building everything entirely from scratch.
There's Civ.
Yeah, there's. I previously worked on a project that was to design a game based around a sort of social AI. So the phrase we like is that a lot of games have a physics engine where the game understands, you know, if you drop something, how fast it'll fall or whatever. So we wanted to create a game that had social physics where if you insulted someone, the game could actually have that character respond in a way that would take into account your common sense impression of how they would respond based on, you know, whether they're friends with you or how, you know, how what their personality is like and sort of all of these factors like that. So we do a lot of cool stuff there. And
what is
to make it the same. It's fun to be sort of double dipping, like working on this game project, but also it's kind of what we're supposed to be doing with our in our day jobs also. So
what institution?
It's at the University of California, Santa Cruz, is where we're at. So
okay, I got a son who wants to go into video game design, and I keep trying to discourage him, and it's not working.
I got one of those.
We've got a pretty good undergrad game program here too. The lab that we're in is under Noah Wardrop Fruin, and then also Michael Mateus, and he did Facade, which is an interactive drama thing. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff. A lot of focus in our lab on sort of like trying to push computer games more into like how can we tell richer stories that react more to the way people are interacting with them, and it's not just sort of like what can we get away with to make it seem like there's a dynamic story, but if you play it through again, then you realize, oh, actually, this isn't that dynamic. So yeah.
Got a couple questions from the audience. Brett wants to know if there's an ETA for release yet, and where to get it from.
We don't have a official release date right now. We're a little behind our Kickstarter schedule, unsurprisingly. I think I read somewhere like 92% of Kickstarters missed their projected date or something like that.
Easy to do.
We're hoping late summer right now. The book, getting the final pieces of the book in place has taken us a little longer than we anticipated just because we really want everything exactly perfect before we send it off to the printers, because then we can't change anything. So the game has to interact with the book, and so we want to make sure the book is exactly right before we take that step. So we're still finishing that up. Once we send it to the printers, there's about a 3-month turnaround time for it to go through all the stages of proofing and printing and shipping to our distributor and all that stuff. So from once the book is finalized, it'll be about 3 months. We're hoping in the next 3 to 4 weeks we'll have the book finalized. So we're thinking, you know, late August, early September is probably the release at this point.
And the way the distribution, we're still locking that down too, but essentially you'll be able to buy the book off our website or off of somewhere like Amazon. And then the game is actually going to be a free download. So the idea is that you can actually download the game and you can sort of start the story with Chris and get a feel for, you know, making the different stories. But then there's going to be a point where he's not going to believe the sort of stuff that you're asking him or telling him Icebound should be about unless you show him proof, which is where the book comes in.
So let's say you order this game from you guys and the package arrives and you're really excited and you open it. What's in there? The book and the CD?
It'll probably be just the book and a link to download the game, depending on your platform.
We're looking into right now getting it integrated also with Steam, which is a popular game distribution service. It's just tough because Steam, I think, is just now kind of getting into distributing physical things as well. Mm-hmm. And so we've got the pessimistic way is saying all the problems of a game with distribution of a book, but the positive way is saying, you know, all of the people who would order books can, you know, they can get these books and then they can download the game, and all the people who play games can download the game and then figure out, you know, that they can get the book. So, yeah. It's kind of, I guess a lot of people say it harkens back to the feelies from earlier games. So there might be a little bit of that in there as well.
Were you guys around then?
Yeah, just barely. I have a couple Infocom boxes that were like the first games I ever bought still sitting on my shelf. So.
Yeah, I played a lot of Infocom, and there was a company called Trillium or Tellarium that went defunct. You know, they had interactive fiction version of Fahrenheit 451. You guys probably played that too. Great game.
The book The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy stuck in the game and was hoping it would give me hints for the game.
I still remember playing that game when I was a kid, and I wrote something like go into the house or something like that, and the game responded with, "It's not a house, it's a home, Bob Dylan." So, is that a sense of humor?
That sounds about right.
Stephen Smith wants to know, what are you guys' favorites? What's your favorite game or games, and anything that really influenced your work? So,
yeah, I think for me lately, one of the most influential games has been Kentucky Route Zero, which, if anyone in the audience isn't familiar with that, is like it's in the kind of format of an adventure game, the kind of classic point-and-click adventure games, but it's really it has a story that's this really kind of intellectual mishmash of sort of computer gaming history and you know, rural Kentucky culture and just all of these different elements that are kind of thrown together. But it's just beautifully, the art is beautiful, the writing is beautiful.
It's very self-reflexive as well, which I'm always a sucker for. Like, it's sort of like, yeah, I mean, there's parts of the game where you're like playing a game inside a computer, inside a game, inside a computer, but then you're playing that on a computer, and so it's sort of like...
It's very mind-bending quite frequently.
Yeah.
But that's one of the games I've played recently that I feel like, wow, people are still going to be playing and talking about this game decades from now, which is a feeling you don't, at least I don't often get in games.
We both played The Vanishing of Ethan Carter also, which I think is a really good game as well.
They sent me a copy of that game, and it's really, really good.
Yeah, yeah, and I love the central mechanic. Again, so I have to make sure there's no spoil, but I really love the central mechanic of trying to reconstruct events sort of retroactively, because I think it really, again, it's sort of like there's not too many ways that they, you know, it's sort of puzzly, but it's not so puzzly that you can get frustrated about it, and the emphasis is sort of on, like, using your narrative sense to figure out how stuff would happen, and yeah, and it's also, it helps too that it's gorgeous, so, yeah.
They did the clues, the detective clues that you're supposedly thinking to yourself, they did it like the first episode of Sherlock, if you guys remember that.
Oh, yeah.
You kind of see the text on the screen when he's deducing things. It reminded me of that.
Yeah,
yeah. I really like that effect a lot. I think it's really cool because it doesn't really get in the way. It's not like shoving it in the player's face and saying, like, no, this is what this means, and the cloud sort of, you know, gives you a sense of uncertainty or a sense of interpretation to it still. So, yeah.
And I think going back farther, like, I've always been inspired by, you know, interactive fiction and anything that's kind of text-driven, because I think that lets you just engage your imagination so much more. And games about exploration where you can, you know, take your time and, you know, are having to constantly worry about, you know, shooting things or whatever. I really love stuff that lets you just kind of explore a really, you know, unique environment. Proteus is another fairly recent game that I liked a lot because it's just kind of a pure exploration game. So,
Proteus? I'll have to check that out. And yeah, what was the name of the Kentucky one again?
Kentucky Route Zero.
Kentucky Route Zero, okay.
Yeah, I'd highly recommend both of those.
Oh, okay, so maybe this is a dumb question, but you mentioned it being available at Amazon in the future. I mean, will some people read the book and do nothing else, or do you, if you get the book, you pretty much need to play the game to understand what's going on, or?
I think time will tell, but I think the book kind of stands alone to the sense that it's this scrapbook of memories and bits of story, so there's not sort of resolution that you might expect from a novel, per se, but I think it kind of is its own unique experience. But that said, obviously it works much better in conjunction with the game where you're getting all of the other pieces of the story and being able to put them together. But I think we do really hope that people can discover it from either side. Like, people might find the book, start reading it, go, what is this? And then find this link to the game and start getting into that from that side. And hopefully also, since the game will be a free demo, essentially people will, you know, try that out, start getting really into it, and then say, okay, I have to order this book and find out, like, you know, get past, you know, get to the end of this. So we're hoping that kind of either side can be a gateway to the full experience.
Do you guys have questions?
Yeah, I've got a question. You were talking about you're having a communication with an AI and you can erase parts of its memory. Are you allowed to, like, if you played it one day, you stopped it at a point, you liked where you were, and then you tried to maneuver the AI down a certain path, and that didn't work, and it went down a totally different path. Are you able to jump back to where you last were?
And just... I can,
yeah.
You might have to live with the repercussions of that, but you can do that, yeah.
It's funny, yeah, I mean, we might build it out more, but, like, right now, sort of, like, if you do that, he'll sort of, like, go back up, and he'll be like, he'll say, you know, obviously the same things again for some of it, and he'll be like, have we had this conversation before? And it goes through this whole thing where it's like, yeah, because you have to, you know, in games you have tutorials to show the you like how to use the game, and he gives you the button to go back up to the previous level, which is the sort of like the erasing button. He gives it to you less, and he actually doesn't explain it. He's like, yeah, and here's the rest of the controls, so we can get back to work. And if you click on it, he's like, oh yeah, so that button. And then he tries to convince you that, like, it's ethically unsound to do that because, you know, would you just erase the memory of someone you're having a conversation with if you didn't like where the conversation was going? And it might be like, yeah, I will. But it depends on the player.
We're definitely exploring. I think very soon, actually, we're going to get into having technology where you do have to start thinking about the ethics of your interaction with it. So I think, you know, most people aren't worried about mistreating Siri on their iPhone right now. Like, they don't worry if they're rude to her or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I think within 5 or 10 years, you know, regardless of whether something will pass the Turing test or can be called sentient or any of those things, we're going to start having, you know, agents we're interacting with that are at least giving a convincing enough illusion of having some kind of, you know, animating force behind them that you will feel bad if you...
I'm not a programmer, but Siri strikes me as basically a if-then type.
2 days ago, I watched the movie Her.
Yeah.
Oh, uh-huh, yeah.
Just like that.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, we it was kind of funny. We were at South by Southwest showing our game, and... And I was demoing it to it, and I got to a certain point, and the guy just started laughing. And I was like, okay. And so I just kept on doing it, and so I gave my spiel. And I finished it, and he said, yeah, that's a really interesting game. And I was like, okay, well, yeah, like, what was so funny? And he said, oh, well, I work at a brain backup company. And he's like, that's what we're doing right now, is we're doing high-fidelity brain scans to back people up. For when we have the ability to simulate them in the future. And I'm like...
So we better hurry and finish this game before it's no longer science fiction.
Well, yeah. Speaking of that, I want to ask you guys this, because Stephen Hawking said it, and now I see that Neil deGrasse Tyson has said it. You know what I'm going to say, that...
And Elon Musk, too.
Oh, really? He's like, yeah. Do not... No AI. You're going to destroy the world. How do you guys feel about that?
Yeah, it's interesting. I think...
I know Hawking doesn't know what the hell he's talking about.
I think we're approaching a time where we're going to have to be considering the definition of humanity again. But this is something that culturally we have gone through before, right? Like, you know, if you look at, you know, like the demise of slavery through the civil rights movement and stuff going on today, you could argue that a lot of that was about the dominant culture, you know, redefining who it allowed to consider as fully human, right? And I think over the next 100 years, it's quite possible that we will go through something like that again, where we will have to ask ourselves culturally this question of, well, this thing, you know, seems like, you know, this AI seems like it's acting like a person and, wants to be treated like a person. Should we treat it like a person, or should we not? And especially once, you know, if we get into a realm where AI can become, you know, be running, you know, simulating effectively, you know, doing things more efficiently than humans or whatever, all of these kind of things, that question gets even more sort of dangerous to think about.
I think one thing that maybe doesn't get said a whole lot in popular conceptions when people are reporting about AI or whatever is that I don't think it's a mischaracterization to say in the AI research community, strong AI, which is like the AI that a lot of these apocalyptic scenarios are about, is kind of seen as sort of like a windmill to tilt at. And it's not entirely clear if we're talking about strong AI, which is AI that is intelligent enough to create, you know, better AI and et cetera, it's not really clear that even with like general purpose intelligence, that's still really in the theoretical landscape. Yeah. A lot of the stuff that I guess is sort of spurring this latest sort of like obsession with AI is the resurgence of machine learning, which is basically like new ways of being able to take all of this data that we're getting off the internet and spying on people and stuff like that, ways to feed it to programs that make them very good at doing certain things. But like, I think we're still a long ways away from even doing stuff as simple as like, I've got a program that's really good at recognizing faces and also knowing when it's socially acceptable to not shout hello at someone when they're passing by. Like, we might actually be a really, like, that might be really far away. But, you know, that like, the other thing,
but
too.
Even there, doesn't it, I'm not a programmer, but even there, doesn't it boil down to essentially if-then statements, you know?
The trouble with a lot of it is sort of, you get into once you start trying to formalize like social conventions and things like that, and also a lot of things that we sort of say like, well, just do this because you do that. Actually, once you start unpacking that and having to program it, you realize that lots of the stuff that we sort of take for granted requires a lot of elaborate coding with machines. Like driving a car seems not like terribly complicated, like. Complicated, but not like terribly complicated. But there are some people who are still saying that Google's self-driving car will never work, like will never ever work, because it relies on baseline assumptions and like a sort of intelligence flexibility that it's impossible to do without supercomputers, and so it's not scalable. That said, I think AI, like AI, doesn't mean human AI too. So right. I can understand some of their concerns about, you know. I think there was a joke that one of our colleagues made that said, you know, the end of the world for AI will happen because the AI making silverware at a factory will get out of control and will just start turning the entire planet into silverware. And it's not that the AI is evil or, like, controlling the world. It just wants to make silverware. And everything that's not silverware is stuff it needs to turn into silverware. And I could maybe see something like that happening. So, yeah, not like death Terminator style, death, you know, by silverware.
But as far as actual thinking machines, you think that's a bit far-fetched? Is it's something I've gone back and forth on myself.
I'm still pretty agnostic on that. Like, I would if someone from 100 years in the future told me, oh, yeah, we still don't have that, I would totally buy it, you know?
Yeah, I'd buy it either way, wouldn't you?
Yeah, so I think it's still up in the air if and how quickly, you know, that will come into existence. But
it's tricky too, because a lot of behaviors, like when you just look at the way something is behaving, if there's an intelligent explanation for it that's simple, then a really complicated procedure, then it's sort of like, oh, it must be smart. But like a lot of this stuff with like facial recognition in pictures, when you unpack what the machine learning algorithms are doing, it can come down to stuff that just doesn't really map over to our concept of intelligence. Like, it might be looking and saying like, oh yeah, if there's like a darker horizontal smudge right here, and then like a third of the picture's ratio up, there's like a lighter smudge, this is totally a face. And you're like, I don't know if that's intelligent facial recognition, but it works on like 99% of our data set. All right. So, yeah, so it's tough to say.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's possible that, you know, true intelligence and self-awareness may be really hard to do, not just in computers and machines, but organically. You know, one of the reasons why we may not have, possibly one of the reasons why we haven't been contacted, you know, the Fermi paradox and all that, is maybe life on other planets, there's plenty of it, but it never reaches the self-awareness stage. You know, it doesn't start building spaceships and atom bombs and things like that, you know.
So. My theory about the Fermi paradox is most civilizations eventually just develop something like World of Warcraft that's so good that for the rest of that civilization's history, everyone's just playing that instead of exploring.
Right, which follows with the Nick Bostrom thing, which, if that's the case, then how do you know it hasn't happened already?
There's a, the Fermi paradox for government funding for space exploration, which is any sufficiently advanced...
There's also that explanation.
Any sufficiently advanced civilization will have a government that doesn't value space exploration and thus, you know, completely traps them on the planet until they can't get off.
Okay, so I got a couple more audience questions here. Brett George wants to know, did you guys play Myst? And I'll throw in Raven into that. Into that too.
I am a huge Myst fan. I have a box at my parents' house that has, I believe, every Myst product ever made in it.
They have like a walk-in closet. You can't have every Myst product ever.
There aren't as many as you would think. But I was definitely really. Inspired by Myst, Riven, and the whole rest of that series. I think, again, like the sort of like thoughtful exploration thing is rare, but it's also hard to do right, where it stays engaging. And occasionally the Myst series would sort of do things wrong with puzzles that, you know, didn't make as much logical sense as you wanted them to. But when they did it right, oh man, they really did it right.
For any Myst or Riven fans out there, it's available on iPhone now, I noticed the other day.
Yeah. I was playing it on my iPad the other day, so, yeah.
Joe Reeves says, I have some technical questions. Is there a specific system, are there specific system requirements for the PC, except for the webcam? And talking about the webcam, I've seen videos of you guys playing the game with an iPad, but I have a laptop webcam. Assuming she's asking, will it work as well?
Yeah. Minimum system requirements.
As long as you have a even moderately newish computer, it should be fine. It's probably not going to run on a 486, but it's not doing anything incredibly computationally intensive. I guess the biggest thing
is that... What are you saying? I can't run it on my Commodore 64?
Probably not. the biggest thing is just that the graphics... the system is actually all written in JavaScript, which was the language we were both familiar with and lets us make it, you know, port it to a lot of platforms easily. But because of that, the animation isn't as efficient as if we had written it in Unity or something like that. That's more natively geared towards doing 3D or doing even 2D animation. So that's actually probably the biggest bottleneck is whether the animation is going to run smoothly on all of the computer.
But I mean, with food for thought, like the computer that I'm developing, like that I'm working on, is a 5-year-old HP laptop. So,
I mean, pretty much handle it for the most part.
And then the one thing that we're sort of like, that's kind of a weird thing, but it's not on Mac laptops yet. We still have to figure out the best way to port it over to that platform, but.
And it's not even the game. It's the augmented reality library. It currently doesn't support macOS desktop.
Yeah, the Cocoa framework. But and then like we said too, you know, because a lot of people also ask like, oh, are you coming to Android or like, what are you going to do that? And then that's comes back to like if two people. So once we release it on that, and maybe if we have some time to catch our breath and everything else, we can look at bringing it to other platforms. There's nothing technically standing in the way of the Android port, just that there's so many different screen resolutions that we want to make sure that the game interface is actually doable, because text is, you want to make sure line breaks and everything else are happening with text where it is, and you can't just make text smaller to make it fit on a screen. Like, after a certain point, you know, it's a no-go situation, so. But,
right.
Yeah, as long as you have a relatively new PC with a webcam or iPad 2 or newer, that should be all you need.
Do you guys have questions before I get to more audience questions? No? A.D. Borman wants to know, what do the guests think of Kurzweil's idea of a singularity? You guys are coming up with good questions today.
Yeah, I think it's the same thing as human level AI, right? Like, I could see it happening, I could see it not happening.
The singularity is kind of predicated on strong AI, which is, like, for people who maybe aren't familiar, but it's sort of like, or at least, and I'll qualify this with my understanding of it, is that the basics of it is that you can make an AI that can make a more intelligent AI that then can then make a more intelligent AI. And so one of the big stumbling blocks for that so far I think, in terms of the research, is that it's not clear yet that strong AI is possible from a technical standpoint in the same way that we say, like, processor speed will be at this point, because we can see that, you know, transistors, we can minimize this much more or whatever. With strong AI, there's still a lot of unanswered questions. That said, you know, we are seeing a lot of acceleration of intelligent programs and hardware. So I think, yeah, and I'm sure there's a lot of stuff that Kurzweil over at Google, who's, you know, what, the lead guy for Google's AI division, I'm sure there's all sorts of cool stuff that maybe we don't even know about. But yeah, based on my understanding, I think it's still up in the air for sure.
Well, he's really, really big on using this to live forever.
Yeah. I mean, I hope that Kurzweil lives forever. That's cool. I do think because I'm a little bit I'm a bit of a pessimist. I have kind of a dark outlook sometimes. I do definitely believe we will live in a future where more people will be dying because they can't afford the medical procedures to extend their life. So I think that the ability to extend people's life will continue to grow, but those procedures are going to be prohibitively expensive. And what we may actually end up seeing in a sort of like Kurzweilian singularity might be more like, if you have enough money, you can live forever. If you don't have enough money, you can live a long time, like longer than you did, you know, before. But yeah, so I think there's interesting implications too, because it's easy when you talk about technology to forget about the costs of technology and the stuff that goes into making, you know, these wonderful machines. But there are costs also. So.
Yeah, it seems almost no question that it would start off that way. Like, you know, when personal computers came out, they were pretty expensive. Now everybody has one.
You know, yeah.
Reached a point, you know, where they, who wants to live forever if I still have to be me? Yeah, that would be awesome. You
know? Well, let's remember that, you know, while Kurzweil is popularizing the singularity, he didn't create the concept, and his technological singularity is just one path.
Yeah.
Von Neumann's singularity, this goes back to 1958 with Von Neumann, and, you know, there are other paths there, and lots of authors have explored it. Greg Bear's Blood Music, the crappy movie Lucy, which I just watched, is a singularity event. You know, I've seen, it's funny because I've seen 5 singularity movies in the last 3 months.
Johnny Depp's singularity.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
It's like very mopey, yeah, but still like totally legit.
Right. So, but there are other ways to get there, and while the technological one is cleaner, a lot of the other ones end up with a very Lovecraftian future. Wet singularities would be very disgusting.
Ooh, I like that phrase, wet singularity. Oh, yeah.
And Werner Vinge has talked about this a lot, and so, you know, even Joe Haldeman in his Forever War series has talked about singularity events. There's a lot of ways to get to that point, and, you know, we have a lot of technology, a lot of different technologies, whether it's biotech or programming or mechanical, that could just force us in the wrong direction. And as in Lucy or Werner Vinge's Time Bubbles, the singularity could come and go, and a vast majority of the population might never even notice.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, it's like, yeah, I can imagine, because, like, I go back, you know, go back and visit my family that's not, you know, because we live pretty close to Silicon Valley. And whenever I talk to my parents or my grandparents, and I'm sort of like trying to explain the stuff that's going on, they're like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, man, when the singularity happens, it might be localized, like localized singularity, right, and then popping, those tech bubbles popping. But yeah.
Exactly. You know, Canada just might disappear one day.
I forget now, this is in, I forget what book this is in, but there's some kind of post-singularity fiction where the machines that sort of go off and evolve into this, you know, higher plane of existence are called the vile offspring by the rest of humanity. And they're off, they go off and start like disassembling the moons of Saturn or something, and no one knows what they're doing, but everyone's kind of terrified of them. I forget now what series that comes from, but I really like that phrase.
Charlie Strauss does this. He had one where like AI started like using up every single atom in the solar system. Yeah. But they didn't mind, like, because it cost them so little when they made their huge mothership or whatever, they allowed an environment for humans to come along and tag along, come, you know, like, commensal organisms, you know, like some ants will have a bug living in their anthill.
Yeah. You know, I really love Charles Strauss.
That's Accelerando is the story, and it is Charles.
Okay, yeah. I'm reading Glasshouse right now, I think, or Window or something. But yeah, like Accelerando is one of my favorite Singularity books because it just it's so out there. And then, man, who's the other guy that did like Manifold Space, Manifold Time?
Stephen Baxter.
Yeah, right? Stephen Baxter. Yeah. Those books are pretty good. Egan
did Permutation City.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's that's more AI than Singularity though.
Greg Egan, yeah. You know, and a lot of this. I've just been rereading Clifford's Simic City, where Earth has been abandoned. Humanity just sort of burns itself out. People just move away from the cities. They become very isolated, and they move farther and farther apart. And one day they discover that, you know, the reason they're not propagating anymore is because their world is awful. They've lost touch with reality. And they all go to Jupiter and become these seal-like things and just frolic in the air oceans of Jupiter. And they leave Earth to the AIs and the dogs.
Well, that's extreme.
Yeah.
Doesn't sound so bad. I'd frolic.
Yeah. And then the dogs sort of like have they gather around the campfires and they tell stories about what humans used to be.
Yeah.
A long time ago, there were these idiots that ruined everything, and then they left. Quick, there's a cat.
Yeah.
Well, what do you guys think of Nick Bostrom's simulation argument? You're probably familiar with it, I would assume, anyway.
A little bit, yeah. So I'm not up on like if there are, you know, recent developments on that, but last I heard, I think it was a thing where he thought maybe there would be a way to do an experiment, but then it turns out you can't actually do that experiment ever or something like that.
No, the way I understand it, and I'm probably going to paraphrase it badly, is, and Pete could probably do a better job, but, you know, any civilization, once it reaches a certain point, is going to start creating artificial reality, virtual realities, artificial realities, whatever you want to call them, which will be populated by beings that can, you know, that are self-aware and can think for themselves.
Or have that illusion.
Pardon me?
Or have the illusion that they're self-aware.
Yeah, or have the illusion, a la Thomas Ligotti, that they're self-aware. So if that happens, then how do we know it hasn't happened already? You know. So he says basically either one of three things happen. Hopefully I remember all three things. Either civilizations never reach that point. They destroy themselves before they reach that point. Or you're in the one reality you're in the top reality, or it's already happened, and numerically, which is the most likely? As long as civilizations reach that point, then just based on the numbers, you're living in an artificial reality, or a virtual reality, whatever you want to call it.
So if things haven't gone to hell yet, it's probably because they're not real?
Actually, we run simulations all the time for, you know, environmental change. And normally the reason we're doing them is because we want to see what horrible things we can do to the system to see how it responds. So, yeah, we might be in hell.
I always appreciate
Florida. Florida is hell. Come on, Pete.
Yeah.
I just watched the Florida Man documentary. I mean, come on.
I always appreciated the Douglas Adams theory that we're all in a giant experiment to determine the meaning of life, but the experiment was flawed from day one in a way that we understand. So
my big fear is that I know what happens when simulations run their course, or they become boring, they get turned off.
Right.
And, you know, everything's just chugging along fine, and then all of a sudden, you know, someone just pulls the plug and says, "Yeah, I'm not paying for this anymore."
Yeah, or it might be like that we're actually in a simulation that's supposed to be modeling like galactic drift between, you know, galaxies, and then some technician is like, "Why is our computer chugging so hard right now?" And then they like zero in, and they're like, there's like a bug over here with this planet. There's like this weird stuff happening that looks like, oh, this is like a whole civilization. Oh, no, this is like worlds of civilization. Oh, axe that planet. We need to get back to the galactic simulation stuff.
That's just a bit of bad coding over there.
Well, I don't think they're going to run virtual reality on Windows.
So you're terrified of that concept that it actually is running on Windows.
Yeah, I think my body's running on Windows. I think so. That's the problem. Yeah, or if, you know, you wake up one day and you figure out that God is a 6-year-old, you're in his video game, you know. So you never know. Okay, so the game will be, it sounds like, most likely available later this year.
Does that seem for about,
about right?
Be a little bit more committal.
Sorry?
Be a little bit more committal with your release date. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Well, we can definitely say it'll be out this year, like, because yeah, I think right now the big thing we're trying to push for is to have it done before summer gets going. But we want to say that, you know, it's like having it finished up and out the door by the end of summer for sure. Because for us also, it's nice to we have sort of like a constraint also of like a sort of academic structure. And so we're about to move on to possibly, you know, other degree work. And so we were like, yeah, let's definitely get this wrapped up so that we can sort of like, you know, close the book on that chapter and open up this other new book and see what that's doing. So, yeah. But, you know, you never know, too. One of the things, like, in the Kickstarter, one of our stretch goals was if we got the last stretch goal, we are going to take the time and invest in being able to make it so other people could write stories using this combinatorial system. We were basically just trying to get enough money that we could sort of like keep ourselves in hot pockets and coffee over another summer. So there is a chance possibly that like we would revisit the work again in the future, depending on how it goes or how the reception goes. But to be honest, we don't really have a model to expect like how the game will be received or how well it will do. So for us, the important thing is to sort of like finish it in a way that we're happy with it, and have that happen soon.
Well, you know what, guys, though, honestly, regardless, anything experimental done well is good. I mean, it's a really, really neat experiment. It sounds like a really neat game.
Yeah, and that's again, like the advantage we have of being in academia is we can fail, and it's not as big a disaster as if we were, you know, 100% of our livelihood was hoping to come from this, you know, selling amazingly well. So, but it's looking, all signs so far are pointing towards it not being a failure, which is awesome. So.
Yeah,
and I think, not.
Yeah, and I think the big thing too with it is that with branching narratives, especially in games, there's lots of people have been doing multilinear narrative, which is incredibly time intensive, because you have to author a lot of content. I think another big thing for this game is showing that these sorts of dynamic narratives are possible without writing a crap load of content that may or may not ever get seen. We're excited about being able to show
It's going to go real well. You guys are going to break a lot of ground, and 2 years from now, if I want to interview you guys, I'll have to talk to your secretary.
We can hope. We dream.
Yeah, who knows? Or maybe your AI
secretary
will interview an instantiate of one of our AIs. Yeah. And yeah.
Joe?
Yeah. You guys brought up the leaves, and you guys have talked about experimental text, and Well, maybe I know a little bit about that, considering I don't use the page the way a normal writer does. To me, a page is canvas. You know, I'm interested in hybrid text, and not computer. I'm not a gamer. I'm a writer. So speak to me about the actual text you guys are using. Is it straight narrative? Is it experimental text? Is it hybrid text? I noticed you guys mentioned the stuff that goes on with Sherlock, and I love that. I think that's a marvelous usage of text within the content of film or television work. But I'm more interested in your text itself, like how difficult it is and whether it's structured in it. Because you also said you're distancing yourself from cinematic technique, which I've been accused of. I literally been told by everybody, it's like maybe if I wasn't so opposed to cinematic technique, my stuff might be readable to the average mundane. But that's not my purpose. So
yeah.
I'm real interested in your text, and I'd like to hear more about that.
Cool. Thanks for asking about it. I would say it differs a little between the book and the game. So the book, reading the book is very much almost like being, I think, a Lovecraft character who has all of these pieces of information that he is sorting through and trying to sort of reconcile. So, one page will have like a letter written, between the author and his daughter. The next page will have, like a fragment of a couple paragraphs from a draft of the novel.
Okay.
Another page might have something else like that. But you kind of have all of these
fragments, pieces, right?
Yeah, and you're trying to figure out, reassemble the story based on these in your head, basically. And in the game, you're doing a similar process, but in that case, all of the fragments are from one particular fiction story. So the kind of the conceit is that as you're working with this AI, this is not actually happening, but in the fiction, the idea is that he's considering he's rewriting the story constantly. He's, every second he's looking at all of these permutations of the story, and you're kind of selecting aspects of the story that you think are most prominent, and then what you get is this series of excerpts from how the story would appear if it were written with those things highlighted. So you'll see a paragraph of text that's maybe from the middle of an argument between two people. And then the next thing you'll see is a paragraph of text about somebody watching a sunrise and, reflecting on their past. And so we're not writing the connective tissue between those, but by juxtaposing them, we're sort of inviting the reader to imagine how the character got from the first moment to the second moment, right?
Which is something I do all the time. It's like, cool. Put your little thinking cap on, because we're not, and I'm not picking on Dr. Seuss or any young adult text, but this isn't kindergarten, I don't believe, or whoever came up with literature should be easy. Fuck you. It shouldn't be,
I think, two pages that we're both working on right now, like just yesterday, although this might fly in the face of cinematic maybe, but an example of a compendium page, I wrote a page from a draft of a chapter, printed it out, and then set up a scene basically where it was like carried it around in my pocket, folded up for the day, and then got home and basically made it out on our table to look like it was a bar, and then sort of like did editorial marks on it and everything else, and then we took put in stuff from like the framing story of Chris or the author as he was writing it in a bar, and then took a photo of that, and that photo will be the page that's in the book. So you get like all of the stuff where you're like, oh, well, you could just write what, and it's like a consistent draft of the book. Or you could look and say like, wait, like this looks like he wrote it in a bar, and actually this handwriting is really sloppy compared to other, like it looks like he was maybe kind of drunk. And then you're like, well, what is this other stuff that was written on here down here? This is like a to-do list or whatever. So there's stuff like that, and then we also have, I don't know, can I show or just...
Oh, sure, yeah.
Yeah, so like this is another page we're working on right now. And this is actually like, we're going to be, you know, this is sort of like composite stuff, but the idea is actually you've got a maze. There's like this maze and there's different segments of it that map to different symbols. And as you're reading, you can sort of read through the maze, but if you get to the dead end, it's like the current thread that you're reading through dead ends. And so as you're going through, but that's been a real challenge to write because it's like almost like an Olympian writing under constraint thing. But yeah, we've been trying lots of different things and having a lot of fun, definitely.
Yeah, and I can definitely see House of Leaves is something like what you just showed up. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, and I think we one of the things that House of Leaves does that we're also trying to do is playing a lot with the reader's perception of the frame, right? So not just that we're giving you a story, but where does that story come from, right? Like we're making you aware of the context of that story and the fact that is a story and the fact that whoever was writing it was trying to, you know, achieve a certain effect or, you know, make the world be a certain way or whatever. So that's something that's always really fascinated me, and that's something that a lot of the writing in this, I think, is kind of given to you in that context. I really, we talk about Pale Fire as being an inspiration,
Okay, wonderful, yeah. And again, I mean, and that's one, those are kind of things where you really speak to me and things that I do. Again, page is a canvas. How thick or thin, simple or complex the language is, I'm controlling the psychology of the reader. I mean, you could go from 8 paragraphs in a row that are single word paragraphs. I'm forcing you to read literally at light speed, and all of a sudden you will hit a paragraph that's somewhere between Herbert Selby Jr. and Ligotti. It's big, it's dense, it's formal. You know, you slam into a wall. So in the context of a scene, I might be trying to describe something, but I may back off from normal narrative description just because visually you're going to be running and hit the wall. I don't need to tell you you just hit the wall. You did it psychologically, and that's what I was wondering if any of those effects played into how you guys are doing the game. Because House of Leaves is marvelous for underscoring. You know, when we're on page 42 and have to go to 367 and turn the book upside down and backwards. Okay, we understand how strange the corridor is now. You know, we are being moved through time and physical space. And then when we have to go back, you know, and check this footnote here and then advance to there and then go back. I just think those could be, and I don't perceive those as parlor tricks. I know a lot of people do. But again, when you're talking House of Leaves, when you're talking Pale Fire, and we could quote all kinds of various things in literature. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, and there's a lot, yeah, I think a difference too in like whether it sort of seems like a parlor trick or actually looks like it's being employed to a good effect is sort of like making it clear that you're sort of conscious of what you're doing as like a decision, like this isn't, you know, yeah, it's like I'm using a footnote. I am conscious of the fact that you're having to turn to the back of the book to look at this footnote, and I've accounted for that. And I think the difference between that and sort of saying, like, oh, footnotes are cool, like, let's put in footnotes. And I think that's actually a really big difference. But, yeah, there's actually, yeah, I mean, there's a phrase for, there's a phrase, ergodic literature, which is sort of like text which requires non-trivial work to actually traverse. And yes, I would definitely say that, like, you know, and especially with the AR component too, that reveals, you know, more text or different parts of the text with the book, that there's, yeah, you definitely have to explore and do some work to uncover it. But yeah,
another thing that's I would say interesting is having to consciously write in a number of different styles, so we sort of had to collaboratively evolve the style of Chris Holmquist, who's the author that the book is about, right? And had conversations about, like, well, what kind of writer is he? You know, does he use a lot of purple prose? Does he have, you know, like, really high literary aspirations, or is he trying to go for a more lowbrow effect? And so It's really interesting to be writing with that consciously in your head about, I am writing as a fictional character would be writing this story, right? So, yeah. So it's been a lot of fun as a writer to, you know, be thinking about all of those things going into this.
I think that's thing I really admire about Nabokov, actually, is his ability between, like, works to switch voices and write in different ways. It just really, yeah.
Oh, yeah, which is an amazing, fun thing. I'm currently editing an anthology, which is a novel-length round robin, and every chapter's by a different author, and they're... In some ways, they're linear, but in some ways, they may not be. That'll be... We'll see when the book comes out. But the vehicle is a Necronomicon that travels through time from owner to owner to owner. So everywhere you go, it's a new setting, it's a new owner, and it's a completely different voice.
Mm-hmm. You know, before I let you guys go, I did have a final question, at least from me. You guys might have a few more. That's fine. But it strikes me that this is the kind of game that's, you know, mystery, maybe some horror, real moody, and the music would have a large part to play in that. I noticed you do have your own composer working on that. Can you talk a little bit about the music and how it comes into play in the game?
It's so good. We're so excited. We found our composer at Indiecade, actually, which is a festival of independent games, and we just happened to end up standing next to him at a party, and we had previously listened a bunch to a soundtrack of his for a different game. And so when we found out who he was, we're like, oh, wow, we love your music for this game so much. And then we ended up working together on this project.
I think it was even, like, we were talking to other people who worked on the team, and we got on the subject of, like, game music. And we're like, oh, my God, like, the music in your guys' game was just, like, awesome. And they're like, oh, you should tell that to the guy standing behind you, because he's the guy that made it. And we're like, oh.
But I've never had that experience of having somebody else, you know, be interpreting you know, my stuff musically, and so it's been really great. We had a lot of kind of deep, you know, philosophical conversations with him at first about what the game's about and what, you know, who the characters were and everything. And he started coming back to us with tests, and we're like, yeah, I like the direction this is going in. But yeah, it's definitely there's a lot of thought behind the music, right? It sounds cool, but it also is really, I think, intellectually engaging with what the themes of the story are too.
Yeah, so. I mean, the big thing about the music is that, like, it's not like totally in terms of the granularity combinatorial, but there is like different tracks that are sort of triggered or evolve based on the choices or the sorts of story that you're, like, choosing in the game to make.
Right.
So as people are playing the game, you've got this, like, moody music, and it's like, you know, it's a problem, right? Because it's like, oh, let's make music for a game, and it's like, yeah, that's great. So you have this cheerful section, and it's playing, like, the same music as, like, this horror game where someone's being, you know, chased by this smot. It's like, no, this doesn't work. And so, the composer, you know, came up with this idea of sort of us being able to trigger things based on the thematic content of what the reader is currently looking at, which is the big thing, is, like, all of Icebound is sort of driven by this thematic consideration. So we already have that information, and he's like, oh, well, I'll just write music to the themes, to these themes or groupings of themes, and then as it's changing, the music itself will change. So yeah, I have no idea how, like, a discrete, like, downloadable soundtrack would happen, but...
Well, there's going to be one.
yeah, but I mean, it's sort of like what those tracks will be or the progression, but yeah, we'll leave it up to him.
That sounds great. I mean, you can really affect the mood of a movie, you know, TV show, game, from the music, so...
Yeah, we're excited about it.
A lot of things would not be nearly as effective as good as they are. They would not be nearly as effective without the right kind of music, well composed and well orchestrated.
Yeah. It's funny because when we first matched up a track with the game and we were playing it, we sort of, like, both started grinning like idiots, and it's like, oh yeah, I guess, yeah, music. We hadn't really thought about that the whole time we were doing all this writing, but yeah, we're glad that we were able to do it because our Kickstarter backers were, like, awesome. So we were able to set aside that money and find somebody that we could pay to do that. So that was also really awesome.
Any more questions, guys? Rick, Anybody?
No, we really wish you all the success. We hope you make some money off this.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thanks. Yeah. Well, I'm sure you'll be hearing about it again. We'll be shouting it from the top of every rooftop when it's out. So.
Well, no pressure. You get to that point, let me know, and I'll let everybody know what's out.
Cool. Awesome. Thanks.
And the name of the game for the audience is Icebound, again, and you can order it. I linked to it on the message board and also on today's post on the website where you can order it. It's $23, and I believe there's some more deluxe editions that you can order as well for if you have tons of money and want to spend more money. So, anyway, guys, thanks a lot for being on the show. And
thanks for having us. Yeah, it was great talking to all of you.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
When you exit, all you got to do is close your browser and you're good. So, right. Thanks a lot, guys. I hope to talk to you again soon.
All right, sounds good. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Take care.
Sounds pretty interesting.
Yeah. Different.
Well, I have to look at that university for my son. Too bad it's in California.
Not for him.
No.
Out
of state tuition's a bitch.
Well, my son's a little younger than yours, but he's saying the same thing. He wants to design video games.
Yeah, it's great, huh? Well, how about, you know, something you can get employment at?
I don't know how this affects my plan to live
what? He's supposed to automatically be a doctor?
No, he doesn't want to do that, but I'd like him to do something where he could actually support himself.
Uh-huh. How do you know that he can't?
I don't know, but you know, I only got one basement bedroom, Joe.
Well, he wants to go to California where there's no parental supervision, and he wants to get a career in something that interests him instead of his father. Sounds like he like wants to grow up and be his own man. What's wrong with that?
Matt, just call him a great idea.
The only thing wrong with that, Joe, is the tuition bill that comes attached to that desire.
Well, Matt, you're the father. You pay the tuition. That goes with the turf.
We get to have a discussion about it, is all I'm saying.
Tell him it's a really good idea, and then he won't do it.
He takes the classes. He learns what it's like to like have an occasional cold one because you spent all that out. You know, you just got out of that lecture and your throat's parched. And it is Friday night, you know, and the bar across the street from the college is filled with lovely young women, you know.
So you're telling me he's going to flunk
about
out?
All that stuff.
You're telling me basically he's going to flunk out?
No. You can go to college and meet young women and
drinking, surfing, and hopefully, you know, with the ladies.
Look, I know is that I did everything that was expected of me, and I got my degree, I got a job, and I was completely
unhappy. I stole my grandmother's car.
Yes.
Okay. I should have a pie on everybody's list of what we want Pete to grow up and steal cars.
Look, I'm saying is that more to life than getting a job and making money.
I'm not worried about the making money. I'm worried about enough to eat.
Well,
you can send him food, or at least money for food.
This is why nowadays they have this device, instrument, and it's called a telephone. And you call home, and it's like, hey, Dad, how are you? And
money.
and can you send me a small check with a couple of zeros, because, you know, like, well, the food budget's a little thin. You know? Think about it. You know what? In actuality, he's got a bedroom, right? He moved to California. He is being generous and giving you back that space in your home.
That's right.
He's not charging you for... You're going to do something in that room. Is he sending you a monthly bill for rent because you took over his bedroom? No.
Okay.
So what are you complaining about?
Keep with the hand waving, Joe. Keep with the hand waving.
Look, but here's the reality is the other day Mandy was talking about taking Peter to tour colleges, and I broke down and you know, had a crying fit. Because I've only got him for 2 more years, and then he's gone.
Oh.
So.
Yeah. You have all that more room to put books in.
No, see, Pete, this is my thing. It's like, yeah, you only got him for 2 more years, but what if you get him back a few years later?
He didn't create the universe.
All he could do is like design little video games that won't sell.
It isn't bad if they come back. Is if they're also, if they're back and they're got a job, you know, at least somewhere. My son still lives with me, but he's pursuing a very profitable legal career now. So,
see, I would not mind if he came back to live with us and worked, because frankly, you know, up until post-World War II, that's the way things were done.
Until
you got married, you didn't get your own house.
I lived with my parents until I was 30 and got married.
Yeah, I know somebody who lived with their parents until they were almost 30. And when they were 18 and they worked, they saved all that money so that when they went out on their own, they'd have a nice nest egg. You know, they didn't...
That's all cool. That's all cool. The key there is work.
Work. Yeah. Work.
You know what? He's still a kid. Let him enjoy his life. He's going to turn 30 and have to get a real job.
Someday he'll turn around and screw it up, but until then, let him be kids.
And this concludes this episode of Parental Advice.
All right. Can we... Did you notice that True Detective's coming back?
Yeah.
Yeah.
In June. It's a trailer, but I have no idea.
History of the American Railroad or something? Who knows?
The trucking system.
I have no idea what storyline is based on the trailer.
Game of Thrones premieres tonight.
All I know is that it stars Colin Farrell's mustache. So.
Yes. Very...
Can I go on a mini tirade about something?
Sure.
This is something that bothers me. And
it's time for mini tirade, yeah.
They're giving credence to this at Necronomicon by naming a panel after it about, did Lovecraft have Asperger's syndrome?
Oh, God.
And I really have some heartburn with this. Because... if you look at the diagnostic criteria and you're any sort of objective, you say, no, he didn't. Okay, end of discussion. I don't even know why this came up. Is it because...
Are you on this panel?
No, I am not.
How come?
Maybe I should be, but then I'd be a skeptic. And that's not what they want, I don't think.
Why? You don't think they want a range of viewpoints? I would rather think they would.
Maybe they would. It's like, I've got a little bit of expertise in this area in terms of having...
A medical degree?
No, not even that, Pete. It's more practical than that. It's people that I've known, immediate friends and whatever, where we've gone through evaluations and set up programs, and I've read a couple hundred papers on the subject, you know... It's not just having the medical degree, it's having a little more practical experience. You know, the thing is, if you look, since diagnostic criteria imperfect, it's you could think of it as on a bell curve. And you think of the two bell curves of normalcy or neurotypical and autism spectrum overlapping, okay? And it depends on where you draw the cut line to say that this is what makes the diagnosis.
Right.
And if you put it all the way over, you overlap a lot of people who are essentially normal. And maybe they're quirky. Maybe they're not the best socially. You know, and then that includes this real broad tent. And okay, you've missed nobody with the diagnosis, but you overestimated the number of people who are just a little bit quirky and they are not impaired by their diagnosis. I don't see how you could ever say Lovecraft was impaired socially. You know, he had so many friends, he traveled so widely. He was considered a good conversationalist.
I was on a panel the other day, a couple months ago, talking about Lovecraft, and somebody brought up that, oh, he was a shut-in, and he never left his house, and, how he was reclusive. And I'm like, it's that damn the camp bibliography again that, they put stuff out there, and then it sort of got a foothold,
Well, it goes back to Colin Wilson's The Strengths to Dream, right?
Right.
But it's, for those of us who are not medically knowledgeable, could you explain, Matt, what Asperger's syndrome is?
Sure. It is basically, unlike autism, there is no impairment in speech development. But what you have is a problem with socialization, okay? So that people have a hard time making social relationships. It's kind of the best way to look at it. Have you ever heard of the DSM-4? The DSM-4 is basically a universal listing of how do you make psychiatric diagnoses. So if you want to, like, say, geez, is my spouse really psychotic? You could look up on the DSM-4, okay? So basically there has to be problems with social interaction, such as there's marked impairment in the use of nonverbal behaviors, particularly eye contact or facial expression or weird body posture. And then a failure to develop peer relationships appropriate to your developmental level. And then you can't share enjoyment with other people because you can't interact with them properly. So you don't reciprocate emotionally the way that you should.
Is it a diagnosis or is it more of a diagnosis of exclusion?
No, it is a diagnosis of meeting criteria.
Okay.
So if you're impaired socially to the point that it is really impacting your ability to function. So, like, then it's associated with stereotypic behavior, such as you have rituals you can absolutely not deviate from. You may body flap or hand wave, or you're preoccupied with a certain part of an object. So you have a very restricted, like, it's a person who the only thing they know are, like, baseball batting averages, and they know every baseball batting average in the book, and that's all they can talk about. They have a very
sound like Lovecraft.
No, it doesn't.
At a wide range of interests.
Right, yeah. But he was also a good conversationalist, and he was very jovial with everyone that he met. He didn't have, all of us have quirks, like you might have your lucky shirt when you watch the ball game. That doesn't make you Asperger's. You're not the same kind of obsessed with it.
Oh, well, yeah.
This is not the same.
And I know people who, among close friends, are very open and warm and funny and whatnot, but among strangers, they're almost crippled and painfully shy. They don't blossom until they feel comfortable around somebody.
Right, I just say that's a personality feature. That's not a pathological problem.
That's what I was going to say. That doesn't mean that they have Asperger's or something. We're made up different. It would be pretty boring if we weren't.
Right.
Well, this isn't Asperger's, but it made me remember a story that I've brought up here often. Lovecraftian story, obsession, Stephen King's short story, or maybe you could even classify it as a mini novella, but short story N, the letter N. You guys remember me talking about that?
Yeah, it was all around obsessive compulsive behavior.
Right.
I really like that story. Gosh.
I do too, and it's really great to listen to too if you have an audible.com subscription. But anyone out there watching right now or later that has not read this story, you really should. I'm trying to remember which collection it's in, but it's in one from like the last 5 or 6 years or so.
I always found it very much like Corner of the Dark.
Mm-hmm.
And at least I think there is a three lobe burning eye at one point in that story, something like that.
Well, it's really good.
Yes,
and very well read too. The story's really good, but you know, it just has that odd added dimension. They've got three or four readers for the different voices in the story. You know, there's one actor for the psychiatrist, one actor for the patient. Not for the patient, but one actor for the sister and so forth. So, so anyway, those of you who have seen House MD, you know those episodes where he's like forced to go off narcotics and he's screaming and locked in the
facility.
He's going through withdrawal. That's what I'm going through right now, but I'm doing it at home. I can't do pain meds anymore, so.
Thanks.
A little uncomfortable.
By the way, I won't be here next week because I'm going to Windy City Pulp Convention in Chicago.
Nice.
Oh, cool.
Drive up that weekend.
We'd like all the viewers to all this week to donate cash, because we're gonna have to bail Rick out a week from Monday. you'll know that Rick's been on the show for years. He's always right next to Pete Rolick. Some of that influence rubbed off. So Rick will probably be in a lot of dive places with stripper poles and alcoholic libations.
And you know, I took you to one strip club, and
you know. Actually, I'm sharing an H.P. Lovecraft panel on Sunday morning.
Oh, awesome!
Wow.
Yeah, well, that doesn't mean you can't be in some low life dive strip joint on Saturday night.
Is there a specific topic, or is it just Lovecraft in general?
Well, it became H.P. Lovecraft and the horror pulps. It was kind of, it developed in an odd way. I was trying to get, there were three, me and two other writers do occasional work for Airship 27, and we were all at done Lovecraftian stories, but I tried to get that panel together, and for whatever reasons, that didn't work out, so it became more of people who wrote pulp heroes battling Lovecraftian monsters. I have to talk to the panelists before to see how we're going to discuss it, but one of them I know is Richard Harvey, who was very close to C.J. Henderson and is reprinting a lot of his works. So we'll probably get...
Well, I have an assignment for you while you're at this convention. Is it pulp convention?
Yes.
All right. Well, I thought there was supposedly rumored somewhere a big budget Doc Savage movie in the works.
It's still rumored. It's supposed to be directed by the guy who directed Iron Man 3.
Hey, did you ever see the original Doc Savage movie? I saw that when I was a kid.
Yeah, I have.
Oh my God, it's like, and I had read like 60 or 70 Doc Savage books, and I want to see it.
I think I had 107 Doc Savage novels.
Yeah, you beat me by about 30. It's like, I was so appalled, and I was only...
I was like 11, 12 years old. I was eating them up like candy. There's nothing wrong with that.
I'm just talking about the movie. It's like...
The movie left a lot to be desired.
I have no fear. The man of bronze is here. Ding. That's like.
That's okay. I didn't like it enough to remember the song.
I'm so glad we recorded that.
You know, it's one of the worst superhero movies ever made, or pulp hero movies, however you want to say.
There are worse ones, but you know.
No, that was.
I saw that at the drive-in. It was pretty good. I enjoyed it, okay?
There's one good scene where they try to kill him with a machine gun.
No, that's where he dodged the bullet, literally.
That's when they all, it splatters his shirt. You see all these bullet holes, and he's still alive. He's got armor underneath.
He looks savage.
Hey, I liked it well enough to remember the song, Joe, so...
Yeah. All I got to tell you is, what year was that? I don't know, 75. 74, 75, something like that?
75.
There I was at the drive-in, my jaw, I was like, huh? I couldn't believe it. I was happy that they made something, anything, you know? But it's high time we get a real Doc Savage movie now.
I'd like to see them have Pat Savage as a character. She's one of my favorite characters.
We want Pat Savage.
Yeah.
But they can
get Will Murray to be advisor.
Right. Well, Will is still writing Doc Savage novels.
Yeah, I know. And he's writing The Avenger. He's doing a lot of that great stuff.
Well, Will has a Shadow versus Doc Savage novel. Trying to have it come out this month. And we're all looking forward to that in the pulp community. He's also doing a Tarzan novel.
I'm not hot on Tarzan anymore. I mean, I was 8 years old. I did my Johnny Weissmuller's thing. I'm done.
I thought the Weissmuller estate. Edgar Rice Burroughs' estate was very reluctant to let anyone else play in that sandbox.
They licensed Will to write a sequel to Tarzan the Terrible. And he's being very coy about this, but he's trying to set up a Tarzan crossover where Tarzan battles somebody.
Not Tarzan Crossdresser? Crossover, okay.
How about Tarzan versus Kazar?
Well, I think it would be more along the lines of, might be, he did the Doc Savage King Kong crossover, so it might be Kong. The hints he was dropping seemed to be something else. It seemed to be some character who has 5 letters in his name.
5?
Because he was saying Tarzan versus 5 X's might happen. So I couldn't think of who this was, you know, unless that's...
Wow, has that ever happened before on this show?
What, an author?
Not thinking of something. He usually has all the answers.
He implied that it was another pulp entity?
Yes.
Hmm.
Kong is not really pulp, but movies.
Yeah, and it's only 4 letters, not 5.
He had 5, so, I mean, unless he just typed that haphazardly.
It could have been a typo. He could be screwing with us. This could be disinformation, that son of a bitch. Ah.
Aaron French edited Monk Punk and The Shadow of the Unknown. He wanted to give away 3 copies today.
Yes, please.
Okay, yeah. Well, I'm sorry,
Dave. just give them out to the... Hey, wait a minute. This is give them out to the panel.
I'm sure he would want to review it, so I'll say something to him.
I can't wait to see the message board after that comment.
I have The Shadow of the Unknown, but it went out of print, and now the people who are trying to sell it want an exorbitant amount of money for it.
Oh, wow. Anyway, if you want that, we'll do 3 winners. Was it a print copy or a Kindle copies? I don't even remember. But anyway, send an email to Lovecraft eZine Prizes, E-Z-I-N-E, Lovecraft eZine Prizes @gmail.com. And just put Monk Punk in the subject. That's M-O-N-K.
Hey, can I give away something?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so I have a brand new copy of Charles Stross's paperback of the Atrocity Archives.
Oh, nice.
Definite must get. That is your window into the laundry universe.
So, yeah, anybody who, send Mike an email and I'll ship it to you.
All right. If you want that one, put Charles Strauss in the title instead of Monk Punk.
I was in one of my favorites. I was in Melbourne, Florida this weekend, and I went to find a new bookstore opened up. And I spent over $80 on books.
And you spent $480 on books?
You know, so
none of the
books had prices on them.
What?
Yeah. So I asked the woman, how much are your books? So I knew, because I'd already found stuff I wanted, and, you know. And she said, well, little paperbacks like this are $1.
Oh, okay.
Trade paperbacks are $2. And hardcovers are $3.
Oh, boy. That could be a fun store.
And I would have backed my car up
today. Matt Carpenter is already buying airline tickets.
His
wife is out in the kitchen tearing her hair out.
And then she says, well, we do have one section where books are a little bit more expensive. And she shows me this little alcove. And I said, well, how much are books in this section? And she says, $5.
Jesus.
Sorry, guys, I got to run. I'll be better next week. I know that. But.
Okay. Sorry you feel bad, Mike.
I have to talk to these people.
Okay.
All
right. I will see all of you next week, except for Rick, and I'll see Rick in 2 weeks. Thanks, guys.
Game of Thrones tonight, guys.